Allora, c'è pure una scarica di questo tipo molto lente, calitante.
E lei invece?
Ovvio, a tutto. Esatto, era emozionato. E infatti quando c'era questo film c'era una massa di popolo.
Mi piacevano dei film, diciamo, strappalati. Tormento, catene. Lì si piangeva sempre, qualsiasi film, lì si piangeva e basta.
Lisa, non mi chiamo più Luisa. Soltanto adesso ho saputo. Poldo Don Demetrio mi hanno detto tutto. Io non volevo, non potevo credere. Ma adesso che ti vedo mi sembra di impazzire dalla gioia, come mi è sembrato di impazzire dal dolore, il giorno in cui ti ho creduto morta. Luisa.
Il mio nome ora è suona dolorata.
Ma no, Luisa, tu l'hai cambiato tra noi. Tu sei sempre Luisa, la donna che io ho amato e che amo.
Il film che ha visto scegliere una emozione che le è rimasta dentro di un film. Qual è la cosa che ancora adesso si ricorda? Beh, mm-hmm. Un'emozione più bella.
Mi accontento.
I'm not going to be able to do that.
reminded me really of team members and, you know, associate partners and, you know, all the bits and pieces that we were able to put together for this project. I'm sure that you've already realized by now that we've been talking about triangulation of data and other things. So, along with the team, also Lorenzo Fenoglio from Memoro and Liliana Riccardi from UNITRE will be participating in the discussion. I'm afraid I have some graphs and numbers and figures, but I promise I'll be brief. This is just to give you an idea of the quantitative results that we have gained from our questionnaires. Some of you probably already know that we've collected over 1,000 questionnaires, and I would just like to give you an idea of some of the questions that we've asked and the results. Before looking into the these figures, I would start by saying that the first question of the questionnaire is, did you go to the cinema in the 1950s? And 977 people said yes, and only 52 said no. But then again, that wasn't a clear-cut no. I don't remember if I was discussing with someone today, and probably Mauro, about this problem we had with some of the questions that we thought were going to be yes-no questions, but they were maybes and, you know, other types of answers. But anyway, overwhelmingly, almost all of our respondents said that yes, they did go to the cinema. In terms of frequency, attendance frequency, as you can see here, the most significant figure is one or twice a month. So they remember going to the cinema once or twice a month with 630, but you also have people going once a week, bring here, and also going less than once a month. So of course that this is an average, so that varies according to regions and rural or urban location and age as well sometimes. In terms of the favorite day, people remember going to the cinema mostly on Sundays. Almost half of our respondents claimed they went to during Sundays, but also any day of the week, 283. I think it's an interesting figure. And then with whom? So here, overwhelmingly, as you can see, friends. Over half of our respondents remember going with friends. But also with family, 322. I think it's perhaps interesting to note here that many of our respondents were children in the 1950s. So family is definitely very important in their memories and their experience of cinema at the time. But also partner, which is boyfriends, girlfriends, and sometimes future husbands and wives. They actually met their future partners in the cinema. Then moving on to Cinema Run, wanted to find out what were the most popular cinema runs. So, well, the figures are not as perhaps significant as others in terms of differences, but we have the second run with 251, but then again, very similar figures for first run cinemas, third run cinemas, and Spanish cinemas. And in terms of the area, where do they go to the cinema? What part of the city? Well, or, you know, in rural cases, there were just, you know, occasions with only one cinema in small towns. But in terms of the area, you can see that in your own neighborhood or in the city center, those are the more significant figures, but you also have people going to other locations. our two favorite film genres. Now, we have adventure here with 479. Of course, it is sort of an umbrella term, so you, under this category you have films like Gone with the Wind, but also what they call pirate films, or often defined film di pirati, and, you know, any type of film really where there is a bit of action. And then you have also love films and comedies, quite a lot of important figures there. But you also have war films, musicals, neorealism, melodramas, and Western films, which we did not specifically in the questionnaire, but it just came up spontaneously from the questionnaires. So another question is, what made you decide on film? So again, as you can see here, genre is very important. So over half of our respondents claim that their choice was based on film genre. Stars were also very important. Over half of our respondents again. But other very important elements were strict publicity, or it was recommended by friends and family. Also press publicity, but also anything available, which was usually the case for rural locations. Okay, my final slide is about favorite stars and films. I only included top four female stars and male stars in the top four films. It has to be noted that our respondents tend to remember the practices of cinema going more than they remember film titles. So I suppose we were expected to have many more titles, but we didn't have many. But then, Gone with the Wind is the favorite, which is also the case for Daniela's pilot project in Rome. So we were betting whether Gone with the Wind be the favorite on a national level as well, and yes. So Gone with the Wind, but then also Roma Città Aperta, Ben-Hur, and Ladri di Biciclette. The difference in terms of views is striking, I think. The female stars, and Sarah is going to talk a little bit more about stars from a qualitative point of view. So just to give you an idea of the numbers here, Sofia Loren and Anna Magnani, Anna Frigida, so all Italian female stars, and then Elizabeth Taylor, the only Hollywood star. The male stars, it was quite interesting. Amedeo Nazzari, which I think is not remembered, or is not very popular right now, certainly, you know, with younger generation, I believe. But anyway, he's the favorite male star. And then you also have Marcello Mastroianni, and then two American stars, Gregory Peck and Gary Cooper. So that's it. That was the last table, and I'll just ask John with more tables after that's not my fault.
Just go on.
Okay, so you've
brought
the hands up.
Has everybody got a copy of this? Well, my job was to... I've spent not the 50 years that Martin spent, but about the last 20 years trying to put together some idea of the various economic aspect of the film business in a variety of historical settings. So I was delighted when I was asked by Daniela if I would join the team to try and put make some sense, if you like, out of the manner by which films were distributed and screened, exhibited, and also consumed in the Italian market. And Daniela and I had a publication in film history a couple of years ago as a kind of prototype for the work that I've been doing just on Rome, and where we married economics and oral history, which I think is a unique combination. never before attempted a walk around.
We know why.
So writing the conclusion was challenging, shall we say. So what I've, as I said, what I've tried to do is, if anybody wants any of this stuff that goes beforehand, then ask Sylvia for the slide, the file. But what I wanted to do is, you know, Italy's a big place. The team were concentrating on seven cities, doing their interviews in seven cities. So I wanted to focus on those seven cities, and the best way that I thought as an entry into this would be to take a snapshot of the film industry in Italy, or the exhibition, the distribution, exhibition, and consumption side of the film industry in a month, January 1954. It's a completely random choice, but it seemed to sort of fit into the middle sort of period that the study covers. So I took January 1954, and then I was fantastically fortunate because Martina helped me with the Rome data set, and Sarah here heroically helped me with the other six, well, not helped me, did them. So what we did was we took the main newspapers of the city, the seven cities, and we found the cinema listings for the whole of January 1 through to 31, and we just made a data set out of all of those entries. And so that leaves us with the first slide that in your handout. So the cities, the cinemas in the sample population expressed as a proportion of the cinemas that were open in 1954 imply that we've got over half coverage. I think we've got all the main cinemas, and the cinemas that we haven't got were in industrial districts, small cinemas, some that were only open for part of the time, some which were open air cinemas, and some perhaps which were parish cinemas. I'm not quite sure how this statistic comes about, but it is one that's given in official publications from the industry. Altogether, so we have, if we come down to the films, we have 731 films screened in Rome, 731 separate films screened in Rome in January 1954. 731 films in our sample of 137 cinemas. So as we run down through the cities of Milan, Turin, Naples, Bari, Palermo, and Cagliari, we see that we've got a number which represents the number of films that we're dealing with. So this is really a heroic sort of data collection. there's a good control in terms of population per cinema. It's fit comparable all the way through, and also the population for each film is comparable across the seven cities. So I was pleased about that. So I want just to draw your attention to two statistics, which in a way describe the incredible unevenness, the inequality, the economics of inequality, the statistics of inequality that characterize the film industry. Do you all know what a median is? If you rank data from the highest to the lowest, then the middle data point is the median. Okay. So median height would be, we'd rank everybody here in a line, and we take the middle person, and that would be the median. So we're going to use the median as a representation of an average. Okay. So the median number of exhibition days for these 731 films in Rome was two days. 3 days, 3 days, 2 days, 2 days, 2 days, 2 days, 2 days. The average film hardly got seen at all by anybody. Okay? This draws attention to the fact that if these were, contrasted to the maximum number of days by the most popular film. So the most popular film in Rome was screened for 88 days, 88 separate exhibition days during the course of January 1954. And we get, again, comparable results here, especially in the major cities. And then we have a large number of films that were only screened for one day. So we have an industry that's able to distribute enormous numbers of films to the cinemas in a particular city. It has to have the industrial organization to do that. This was an extremely well-organized distribution and exhibition system. So even though Italy had come out of the Second World War as a damaged entity, although there were very high levels of poverty throughout the country, particularly in the south, although there are all kinds of political uncertainties, certainly up until the 1948 election, it nevertheless, its cinema industry seemed to recover extremely quickly. So this in 1954 is very little different to what you would see anywhere else in the world. You had a functioning cinema industry in a capitalist economy. So the characteristics that we have here would, I suggest, be the same anywhere else in the world at that time. So the next slide I want to show is just, so we're just talking about film circulation, not popularity at the moment. Those films in circulation in these seven cities in 1954. In order to, the slide would be too small, the entries would be too small if I included all seven cities. So I've just included the largest four cities and just looked at the circulation statistics in the largest four of our sample of seven cities. So The Prisoner of Zenda was got the 88 exhibition days and was screened in 21 cinemas. 21 cinemas during the course of January 1954. In Milan, Moulin Rouge, another American film, was shown in 21 separate cinemas for a total of 102 days. Think now about the median. The median film got 2 days. These are outliers. These are what I term better than outliers. These are extreme events. The film industry is characterized by film events. The statistics in Turin and Naples aren't so extreme, but it gives you an idea of an efficiently functioning film industry. Films went out to audiences, and I would suggest the reason why these films went out to audiences was because they were popular with audiences. That is, the economics of the film industry is that you make those films that are most popular less scarce, and those films that are not popular are more scarce. The whole economics of the film industry is that you circulate films to generate revenue. You maximize revenue by getting those films distributed as far and as wide as possible. And this is what we have an example of here. Okay. So, it's going beyond January 1954. So I asked then Sarah, thought that she might have finished, but then I asked her to go back into December and out into February. And she went back further than that for some films. So what I've done now is, this is an Italian film, Anna Facile, Actually. I've been practicing all lunchtime, that's why, for a while, and I still didn't get it right. Anyway, but what I wanted to show here is just a typical pattern of distribution. So the film starts at the first run cinema, Missouri, and it runs for 16 days in December. It then goes to December 1953. It then goes to a second run cinema, Del Verne, and it plays for 8 days in January. It then goes to a set of third run cinemas where it plays for 6 days. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cinemas where it plays between the 13th and the 18th of January. Then it goes out to a whole set of other third and fourth run cinemas until its life cycle comes to an end in the city of Milan on the 21st of February 1954. Thereafter, as far as Milan audiences are concerned, it's dead. It's no longer a commodity. It was a commodity, but it was no longer a commodity on the 22nd of February because it had gone. You weren't able to see it again. So it has a life cycle, like all films have a life cycle. The days that we live in now are extraordinary in the sense that this period, they're extraordinary in relation to the history of cinema because we no longer lose films when they stop being distributed in cinemas. We have other means of accessing those films. But at this time, there wasn't that access, and therefore they were dead commodities once they stopped their life cycle. So we can do this. You've got this profile here of Anna Faciolo. We can do this with any film. So we could do an analysis of the life cycles of films if we wanted to, if that was part of an analytical exercise that we wanted to conduct. Now, what I did was circulation just tells us it's a snapshot. It doesn't tell us anything about necessarily, it doesn't tell us the whole story about the popularity of films that had been that were screened in January 1954. To do that, because films have their own life cycles, those films screened in January 1954 may well have been premiered in September 1954, and they may well have been premiered in January 1954, but in fact had a run that didn't finish until, let's say, May 1954. So in order to capture the box office of all of, so what I wanted to do was see how popular those films that were screened at least once in January 1954 were in relation to one another. Yeah. So it means going back to September 1953 and forward to about May 1954 to capture most of the films. There's this fantastic, it's not altogether consistent, but there's this fantastic bulletin, organ, I suppose, this fantastic magazine, film journal, called Bollettino dello Spettacolo, and every fortnight it published box office information about the leading cities. So I think this is unique. I don't know of any other comparable source to this, but it enables us to It enables us, but we don't have the data for, we don't have Palermo and Cagliari are not featured, but Milan, Turin, Naples and Bari are. And what I haven't got time to, you know, there's tons of stuff, you know, there's tons and tons and tons of stuff. But what I've done is I've looked at the box office, the actual box office, of the leading 20 films that were screened in Rome. So these are the top 20 films screened in Rome. And I've compared, so I've then tracked their performance in Milan, Turin, Naples and Bari. And I've expressed the box office that they generated as a proportion of the median film to get some sense of the extremeness of the statistics that are associated with popularity. So we see La Tunica, which is the American film produced by Fox, 20th Century Fox, called The Robe, set in ancient Rome. It was extremely popular right the way across the board. I think in Barry, what is second most popular? But anyway, it was the most popular film across all of the cinemas, and it achieved these, it was 10 times. So if somebody's twice as big as a medium person, they're tall. If they're 10 times, they're a giant. So we've got these very, very high multiples here in the statistics. And I haven't got time, but what I want to do is just refer, so what can we do with all of this? Well, we've got, this gives us an indicator of preferences, an index of preferences. So the next question, a question could be, are the preferences different in different parts of Italy? Can we distinguish? So, I draw your attention to Il Ritorno di Don Camillo. And Catherine here is an expert on that film. All right, who's an expert on that film? Who knows the film? Where's it set?
It's set in Brescello.
And where's Brescello?
It's between Emilia Romagna and Lombardia, northern Italy.
Northern Italy, yeah. Right, okay. So it's geographically specific, and it's about a communist mayor,
yeah,
and a Christian Democrat
priest.
Exactly.
Okay. So it's a very important film for that period of time. And it was extremely, look at Milan, the multiple there, and Turin, the multiple there. And compare that to the multiples in Naples and Bari. We have differential performance of this most well-known film, this classic Italian film. We've got differential performance of that film in different parts of Italy, different cities in Italy. Now this then gives you the basis, if you like, for doing some theorizing, some explanation. We could do this, not surprisingly, this film here, which refers to the map of the people of Naples, Neapolitans, has a big multiple down here, 7.03. So you have some notions of locality in this data series. There's any number of ways of diving into this type of data and picking out interesting statistics and differences between films in different cities. And this just gives you some kind of flavour of the kind of work that we're hoping to do as part of the overall project. Okay.
In approaching the question of stardom, we're obviously interested in the way that stars might have influenced post-war identity in Italy. And as Sylvia mentioned, the question of stardom was worked directly into the questionnaires. So we asked respondents to name their favorite male and female stars and to explain why they chose those particular stars. Now, when we moved to the video interview stage, this question wasn't actually repeated in the video interviews. Rather, we have a case where the references to stars came about much more organically depending on the interviewee's individual memories. In both the questionnaires and the video interviews, we asked respondents about fan practices such as writing to stars and collecting memorabilia, and we did this in order to understand how or to what extent audiences engaged with stars. So just briefly to mention a little bit about the methodology and how we went to do the qualitative analysis of the questionnaires and also the video interviews. So we use this software, which is MVivo. Some of you might already be familiar with it. I'm just taking the area of stardom in particular. When we looked at the qualitative data, we organized or tagged it into different categories. So under the heading of stardom, we had responses that dealt with questions of acting skills, identification, in some cases anti-identification, references to the star's physical appearance, and then references to specific roles that they may have played. What I'm going to do now is just give you a very brief kind of outline of the main findings from the questionnaires from the qualitative analysis that we conducted. So as Sylvia already mentioned, for both male and female stars, Italian actors were the favourites. And this is despite the fact then that the favourite film was actually a Hollywood film. After genre, actors were the second most influential factor for audiences when deciding what film to see. And this emerged from the questionnaires, but also we saw evidence of this in the video interviews. So I just, this doesn't work, I don't think so. I need to, I'll just come out of this for a second and show you.
Cinema, appunto, quando lei era giovane, questi molti film che lei ha visto, le cose che rimanevano più impresse in questi film riguardavano di più la storia, quindi la narrazione, o gli attori, la loro figura, o i costumi, le scenografie, quali erano gli elementi che rimanevano, diciamo, più nella sua...
Principalmente la... subordine la maniera in cui ho presentato, l'interpretazione degli attori, dei grandi attori, c'era un film che era interpretato da una, prendiamone se l'Anna Magnani, perché attiva, questo l'ho fatto, non sapevo, e quel film era, c'era Anna Magnani, allora la gente andava a fare attivata dal personaggio di Anna Magnani, ai tempi di andare più indietro, se volevo, Rossano Brazzi, si ricorda per il delle donne specialmente che erano per l'uomo, cioè le ragazze si ammiravano Rossano Brazzi.
E il regista può essere un elemento di attrazione per il, diciamo, la memoria
no,
della prima scelta del film?
Non troppo dalla verità.
Antonio's comment there that the director wasn't particularly influential is a trend that we have seen throughout. Obviously, some interviewees who were more cinephiles would have been aware of particular directors, but the general preference was for they were attracted by the star. So then when we looked at the questionnaires from the point of view of what audiences have to say about performance, very often they don't address this directly. So we kind of have to glean references to performance in a roundabout way in terms of what they say. And when it comes to male stars, they are more frequently associated with versatility in their performance style. And interviewees reference their ability to shift between different registers. So we have an example from the questionnaires here where a female respondent talks about how Alberto Sordi was both a comic and a dramatic actor. It'll be no surprise to anyone really that by contrast, female stars were more frequently remembered for their appearance or specific physical features, as in this example here where a male respondent refers to Sophia Loren's Juno-esque physique. So star performance is very often remembered in affective terms. And you can see an example here where this lady from Milan province talks about how she was moved to pity by Silvano Mangano's performance in Rizzo Amaro. And then identification with stars and characters is not exclusively a female phenomenon. Indeed, memories of identificatory practices such as copying the fashion of a star or maybe a particular mannerism is something that is expressed by both male and female interviewees. And Catherine will talk about this a little bit more in detail, I think. But it is fair to say that these kind of memories of identification are more frequently associated with female interviewees. They're more inclined to express these memories. The audience star relation with Hollywood stars often inspired aspiration, and a number of female respondents from Calgary in particular cited Marilyn Monroe as a role model and an ideal of femininity to strive for. And I know Danielle will talk more about female cinema goers who viewed the Hollywood star Esther Williams as an aspirational figure. And then the last point I'm just going to finish on is how Italian stars, often they were talked about with this sense of proximity, which was attributed to a shared regional or national identity. And quite often Anna Magnani comes up in this context. So we have a female respondent, obviously here from Rome, who talks about liking her in particular for her Roman personality. And they also make references to her accent or the fact that she was speaking dialect. So we're going to pass over to Danielle.
Thanks, Sarah. So I'm just going to talk for a few minutes about a particular perspective on this data, which is really inspired by a few comments and one video extract. So I'm sorry, I'm starting from the very small on this level. But just to explain where it's come from, I approached this project really with a great interest in finding out more about how women viewed cinema. And at the same time, I've been reflecting a lot on the fact that many of our interviewees and respondents were actually children or teenagers during the period that we're asking them to remember. So with this in mind, I've really been thinking about how to put our research in the context of another field that I'm involved with, which is the question of girlhood studies. So one of the kind of leading theorists in this field is Marie-Celeste Carney, who talks about the fact that although Simone de Beauvoir's most profound assertion, one is not born but rather becomes a woman, begins her exploration of how femininity is produced during childhood, an analysis of how one becomes a girl is not her objective. So what Kahn is arguing for is a focus on the figure of the girl in a non-future determined way, so thinking about girls' experience as opposed to girls as future women. And in many ways, putting this into dialogue with the research that we're doing, and the importance of doing so, was reinforced for me when I came across an article in Oggi from 1952 that referred to girls as donne in miniatura, so miniature women. And I know that Enrico Caposotti, amongst several other historians in Italy, has spoken about the question of the emergence of girlhood as a category in the 1950s. Of course, one major question is whether or not through the filter of memory and a web of adult perspectives in the 1950s, it's possible to reach back to the experience of girlhood in that cinema at all, because frequently it's predetermined. So, for example, Alma talks about how in cinema ha inciso sul mio modo di essere come donna mi ha dato una femminilità, although she's actually describing an experience that she had as a young girl watching a film. She talks about it making her into a woman, so that obviously remembering and thinking back through the filter of time, people are thinking about what cinema's made them become. So accounts are in some ways dominated by the notion of an adult gender acquisition. But I'd like to see really, and I think there are areas in our findings that suggest spaces where we might see traces of what it was like to be a girl at the cinema in Italy. So if you like, what I'm trying to argue for is a cinema paradiso al femminile. So this idea of what is the girl's perspective on Italian history. So in order to, obviously, we'll eventually put this into dialogue, I'm sorry this is quite brief, but with the work that has been carried out by Annette Kuhn and Jeffrey Stacey on female cinema going, but also the wealth of material that's now emerging in the Italian context of mentioned. But also there's been work on letters to women's magazines. Casa Magnaghi Cardone, obviously also Sarah's work, which some of you heard earlier, Fan Mail, Rebecca Buckley, Federico Vitella, and also Diaries. I know Federico's recently published an article on that, Tony Damiano also has something forthcoming, which I'm looking forward to reading. And then, of course, some elements of oral history have been very important. There was a film called Le Signore Senza Camelie, made by Guido Guglielmo in 1988. Of course, the Maria Grazia Franchi's work, of which this is just one example from 2007, and for Gatchen Gundel. So I hope to draw upon this existing work in order to create this percorso, if you like, this pathway through our research. But just to give you one brief example of that today is the question of Esther Williams. So Esther Williams was a synchronized swimming star, for those of you who don't know, who originally began as a sports star, couldn't make it as a sports star, and then began to feature in films such as Bathing Beauty in the early 1940s. A very glamorous star, but who was very much the focus was very much upon her performance. I'll come back to this slide in a moment, actually, because I'd just like to show you some of the comments that our respondents made in our questionnaires, and these are all female comments. So her way of dancing on the water, she was a mermaid. Bathing Beauty is cited as a favourite film with Esther Williams. I love synchronised swimming. Somebody explains their love for Esther Williams as a star. She was beautiful. The swimming choreography, the dives in her film. And then a lady from Naples talks about her beauty and her professionalism. And these are a few quotations, and of course Esther Williams is also meant remembered by male interviewees. But what struck me about the quotations from the female respondents to our questionnaires was the emphasis on her movement. So just to go back then to that previous slide, this kind of struck a chord with something that Kirsten Pullen has been writing about the star Esther Williams. She sees her as someone who is representing the body as active at the same time as spectacular, talking about how the material body crafts cinematic performance, suggesting feminist possibilities within conservative texts. More importantly, she develops a strong repertoire of movement, one that suggests that women are strong and independent when they trust their bodies to perform physically. And it was this particular connection that interested me, because, of course, there is an immense amount of data about women copying film stars and primarily copying their looks. What we have much less of is information about any female audiences copying women's movements, particularly their sporting movements. So this was what interested me particularly about this fandom, if you like, in relation to Esther Williams. And then when we came to analysing our video interviews, in fact, I found so far at least this one example of somebody remembering Esther Williams, and I'd like to just share that with you now. So this is Rosangela from the Torino. Rosangela was asked here to say whether she found that she'd learnt anything from cinema, and this was her response.
Titolo del film di Esther Williams, queste sue abilità di nuoto, e ad esempio era qualcosa di insegnamento anche del movimento a noi che il nuoto lo praticavamo nel fiume Po o nei piccoli laghetti che ci sono attorno, e quindi ci cercavamo sempre di seguire queste cose.
Suggested from her study of memories of cinema going in Britain in the 1930s was that by comparison with men, women offer few recollections of childhood play and make-believe inspired by films, and their accounts rarely include memories suggesting freedom of movement in open spaces. Now perhaps this is merely an exception, but some of the other kind of lines of investigation that I'd like to follow emerge from the powerful responses from some of our female interviewees regarding their passion for pirate films, their imitation of westerns. And here we have a nice example, I think, from Carmen, who with her sisters used to make their own cinema di cartone using a shoebox and the comic strips from Il Corriere dei Piccoli. And again, I would like to make a link, even if it seems a little sort of far-stretched, temporally to what Maria Grazia Funky was talking about yesterday, in terms of girls as prosumers, girls creating their own media, because here we have an example of girls showing an interest precisely in that hands-on physical kind of activity, but clearly it isn't one that they find any space in which to take further, such as towards the Cine Club and the Cine Amatori, that was sort of quite popular in that period. So we don't know whether women went on to do that. So far from our research, we haven't found any evidence that they did particularly, but it would be interesting to know more about those connections. So it seems to me that what emerges from our interviews is that there is this glimpse, if you like, into a girl that was not all about becoming woman.
I'm just going to talk very briefly about the kind of specific challenges of using video interviews, both the challenges and the rewards that it brings. And obviously, as I think we mentioned, we had two stages to the project. So the first was the written questionnaires, and the second was the 160 video interviews, more or less 30 to 40 minutes long each one. And one thing I want to emphasize is that when we were doing the video interviews, we didn't want to see these as just another source of information, you know, just collecting more stuff about what people did. So we were trying to develop another way of thinking about what these audiovisual sources might do for our project and our findings. And obviously, one of the things that, and this has been a big source of debate within the field of oral history in recent years, the importance of kind of being able to restore some of the qualities of speech and the performative aspect of interviews through using audiovisual technology. And so digital technologies obviously now help us shift focus, so we don't have necessarily the loss that we might have had, you know, with a written transcript of certain aspects, what Portelli calls the rhythm of popular speech, which is so important in getting to this affective quality of what cinema meant to people. And also thinking about the focus, the shifting of the focus to what Michael Frisch calls aurality, so embodied voices and context. So we are very interested both in how cinema was an embodied experience for these young people, but also how the memory of it, the actual process of recollecting for it, is also embodied or kind of lived or relived in sort of bodily fashion. This is something that relatively little attention has been paid to, and certainly not at all in the Italian context to date. So obviously, using video technologies, which we've done in a very simple way, allows us to capture body language, facial expression, laughter is a very important one, smiles that kind of occur at certain moments, and foregrounding other dimensions of representation. So as I say, we're aiming to kind of analyze or address this kind of somatic, sensuous, affective involvement in cinema. This is what Annette Kuhn has talked about in her work with UK cinema goers. So I just want to show two very brief clips to try and kind of show some of the challenges and the rewards of doing this kind of thing. So looking at Giorgio in particular, who's my favorite, from Turin, and here he is talking about.
We started in 2008, and we at the beginning we was thinking that the memoir project should be very interesting also abroad than Italy, because we started in Italy. And now we have in 14 countries all around the world, we have a memorial project site. The most interesting for us, because we can understand everything, obviously, are Korea and Japan. Here there is people that speaks Japan, obviously, or Korean, and they share their memories with all other people that can understand Japan or Korean. And we knew this project, we met Daniela in 2009, I think it was, and we tried to collaborate with your project. So last year we made 160 interviews, video interviews, all around the Italy. There was we take 8 big cities, and then we go to make for each city 5 men interviews, 5 women interviews, and also for this city we made 5 men interviews and 5 women interviews in countryside of the city. So we collect 160 interviews. Now we would like to help the project to try to normally in other European project the dissemination of the result of the project. So we are trying to help Daniela and all the project with an idea that starts from the tools that they are using now in the project. From we took NVivo coding. They are every interview is coded on NVivo, and we try to put the coding inside the video. So here is very little. I'm so sorry, but here on the right we have all the coding that was made in NVivo. And if you click on one reference, as you see, like this one, we can start with everyone. The video starts on that reference. This is only the first idea of creating this kind of this database that match the one tools that is, I think, use all around the world, like NVivo, and also the video interview. Try to share this result using the internet. This is only a first, and then we want to go further and try to put all the 160 interviews inside this kind of software, and help everybody that if someone clicks on etiquette and cinema, he will see the references in this video, but also at the bottom he will see all the video that has the same references in the same reference. So this is only a first point, but we would like to share it with you and also to try to develop in. This is
I think you got two very smiley Danielle and Catherine that didn't know about this. This was a surprise. That was sort of, you could just see the eyes. That's fantastic. Thank you. It's not just one thing, Lorenzo. It's a major achievement for us, which really sort of goes back to exactly what Catherine was saying about sort of ensuring that the memories are as sort of can go back. Sorry, I can't really see what I'm doing here. Right, I think that what we have presented really has been partly the challenges that we've had in the project, which I think have been many, and I'm sure that we can sort of stay here all day to talk about it. Some of the methodologies and different approaches. Of course, we looked at gender and stardom and programming, statistical analysis. We have stretched beyond that. We presented on elderly as discriminated users in audiovisual cultural heritage. Sarah's just come back from an interesting conference in Lucca on a project of digital technologies and the attempt to sort of discuss the building an archive of memory, but also sharing them with researchers and non-academic users. So we've also worked on the geovisualization of the data, sort of mapping memories and mapping exhibition and programming. So there's been quite a lot that at academic level we tried to work on, and sort of we are now in the process of writing up and disseminating it through conferences. But I think that what I really want to reflect on is what we have done and what we're trying to do beyond the academic community, and that is really trying to go back to those that were the focus of our project, which are the audiences. And I was in at the Banksy exhibition in Rome a couple of months ago, and I found this beautiful picture that I thought represents very much what we were trying to do. And I think it's sort of the Martin was talking about cool, something the Orlando Bloom being cool. I think that we were trying to make those memories, not we, but I think we're sort of acknowledging really the importance of those memories. I think one common theme that came up by sort of people that were being interviewed is, I haven't really got anything to say, and actually, and even if I do, it's not really relevant. Actually, it is very relevant, and it was wonderful to have the opportunity in a series of events that we've organized, both in the UK but predominantly in Italy, that we call the Sharing Memories event, where we had the opportunity of bringing those memories back to people that have actually been so generous to share them with us. And the fantastic thing is the ownership of those memories. We've had, Sylvia and I had an example in which we were trying to validate those findings, so we would come up with some ideas of what we thought certain data would mean, and people would feel so strongly about it that they would jump on stage and steal the microphone and tell us, in case we got this wrong, this is not right. And I think it was quite extraordinary how so that those memories were really important to them. Liliana is here to represent UNITRE, the University of the Third Age, and they have been absolutely fantastic in helping us, or actually collecting the data, but also helping us to go back to the audiences and sharing those memories with them. I know that Liliana wants to say a few words to us. Yes.
I try to enter in English. Good morning. Today I'm delighted to be here in Oxford to represent Gustavo Buccini, the president of the Italian UNITRE, the University of the Three Age Voluntary Organization. In Italy, we have had the pleasure of collaborating with the Italian cinema audience team, especially with Daniela Treveri and all her staff, involved in organizing the project about cinema and life in Italy during the years 1930-1960. Together, we have organized events in Messina, Potenza, and then in Torino, where we concluded in the cinema museum with great success and an enthusiastic audience. UNITRE in Italy hopes to collaborate in the future, and we're delighted with the special friendship we have with the Italian cinema audience team. Thank you.
I just want to show you just a few comments. What we did in the event that Liliana referred to in the Cinema Museum in Turin was collecting some feedback forms, and I just want to show you some of the responses. I don't really know whether you can see it, because I think that what those bringing memories back was also an opportunity to trigger new memories and trigger discussions. So we've got here, il cinema è vita e sogno deve essere più conosciuto, il cinema è di tutti e può diventarlo con progetti come questi. Cinema is for everybody, and it can become even more like that with projects of this kind. Perché I ricordi visibili sono più speciali che quelli della sola memoria. This is something that keeps on coming up, and I think it's sort of really strengthen the idea of using video interviews in a way, because it's really the visual aspect of memory. Visual memories are more important, or actually are stronger than just memories. Ricordi nascosti in un cassetto, e dimenticati, ripescati con il vostro aiuto, grazie. So memories that were hidden in a drawer and they were able to be fished out again with your help, or dormant memories that the project have been able to sort of get back to life. And I think that is really, it's a very interesting way of really thinking about memories that are there, but through project of this kind, they've got the opportunity of coming back to life and being shared. The other thing that we did in May this year was a pilot project in collaboration with a school in Rome. And we thought that the next step really was to find a way of sharing the memories further. We collaborated with the school, where school children and their grandparents had the opportunity of discussing memories of their neighborhood by looking at venues and cinemas, and obviously the memories of cinema going in 1950s. And in a way, it's one of the many things that the Italian Cinema Audiences project has left us with. I think there are probably many sort of directions that we could actually go. But I think that we felt that there were two aspects that we really needed to do. One was integrating personal memories into wider contexts. And also the second part of it was sharing them with younger generation of audiences and not just users. And in order to bring together personal memory and the archive, what we're hoping to do now is to develop a new digital infrastructure that will advance our understanding of cinema going and memory by interweaving all our history and contextual information from several Italian archives. More than just a sort of a repository of information, a static repository, the digital platform will serve as a living archive that both hosts and facilitates this intergenerational sharing and interpretation of memories. The van in the picture, which is my van, is our next step. So the first one would be to sort of attempting at creating the platform, and this is what we're working on at the moment. And then we'll just jump on the van and hopefully travel around Italy to find a way, sort of through a traveling project across the country, to disseminate this living archive and facilitating the sharing of more memories. So this is these are our hopes for the future. I've got to do this. I really want to do this at this point, which thank everybody, and you will have to bear with me, because I think, as Martin said, you probably realize that this has been a big collaborative project, and I really feel I want to thank everybody that has been involved in the project and has helped the project come together. And I'm going to start by thanking our advisory board, Maria Grazia and Martin, that have really guided us through, not from the beginning of the project, but much earlier on. we were trying to find out when it was, and I think we had a meeting at the Screen Conference in 2007, you know. And yes, I think we've been haunting Martin and Maria Grazia since then, constantly asking for support and suggestions and advice. And they've been extremely generous and helpful throughout all this period. And in fact, I just want to warn them that the job is not finished yet. So just things are coming your end. Obviously, Bobby Allen, that has been really helpful, not just with his fantastic project that he has shared yesterday to all of you, and that for us has been a real inspiration, but also through discussions, so through the use of the digital, the DH Press facility, but also through discussions when our ideas were terribly vague. And I think he was very kind not to sort of tell us that. Our partners in crime, Blue Media, that helped us to collect the questionnaires, Memoro and Unitre that have helped us with the questionnaires and the video interviews, because they really were extremely professionals and they allowed the data collection in such a smooth way. We would not have been able to do any of this kind without you. I did Rome as a sort of a mini project and it was hell. So thank you very much for actually helping and also for getting really going out of their way to do things that they were really not requested to do, and they did, and it was absolutely wonderful, and I really think that, thank you very much, thank you. John, we've actually found a definition for John, our economist in residence. I think we've got to have it on the website. John has been fantastic because I think he sort of, he jumped aboard a very wobbly ship when we first asked him, we didn't even know what to do. And I think he was very enthusiastic, and so thank you very much for actually widening really the scope of the project. I don't think there's any mention of programming and that sort of a fantastic new insight into the data in any sort of application that we have done. I also want to thank everybody that is helped for the conference, because this conference has been great because of the help of Silvia and Teresia that is hidden down there, Nikki and Hannah that have helped greatly, Miguel who is there behind, Gav who is not present today but sort of helped before, and Tom that was filming yesterday, I think sort of going through a lot of bureaucratic issues from trying to sneak some Prosecco bottles into university sort of constraints to all sorts of other things that I'm not even going to mention, they have been great and they've done it very gracefully. And obviously now to the Italian Cinema Audiences team. Daniel, that you all have to look, is there, he's very quiet, show yourself. He's the one that managed to create the wonderful website that we have, and if you haven't seen it, go and have a look at it, because it's fantastic. And he has really solved promptly every query we've had of any kind, and any sort of strange request. Alex Friend, yes. Thank you. Our NVivo is an ArcGIS guru that sort of accepted to sort of jump and help every time an NVivo file crashed, which happened a few times, I think. And every time we ask on a new idea and do sort of cross analysis of the data, Alex will come up with something new, which is great. Sarah, we're pretending that it was just a PhD. That was the false pretense, and she started doing that. And as you can see, she's sort of done absolutely everything else. Like, can you present a paper in a completely random conference? Can you present here because the speaker has gone? Can you do the programming data? She's done absolutely everything, and it's been really great. Thank you very much. Sylvia, the real asset of the project, the one that keeps me, Danielle and Catherine in place at bay. She's got an amazing eye for detail, and she really sort of scrutinizes everything, rightly so, because we don't. So thank God we got her. And also, she's always saying yes to every sort of challenge of any kind, you know, whatever you propose her, she's ready to start that and go for it. So thank you very much. And obviously, Catherine and Danielle, I think we managed to go through this sort of a 10-year marriage without a major disaster from a really dreadful start. I think the biggest hurdle was actually submitting that funding application. I think we still get spots every time we think about it. And we've been there. I think that you have been great because you never gave up. And I think there were moments in which we were quite desperate, but we didn't. And I really hope that the Italian Cinema Audiences 2 is going to happen, so we've got more years to test this very weird marriage. Thank you. We've got questions, if you do. Or comments or anything. I think we've got time, haven't we?
Yes.
I Alex, I'm worried.
It's just an observation. It's interesting that the cinema owners regarded their clientele in, well, a slightly contemptuous way. Perhaps that's putting it a bit strong, that they were naive and simple. And then when you hear them expressing, putting words to their memories in a very articulate way and very sophisticated language, that's quite an interesting contrast.
Yes.
I mean, I don't know if the ones that you showed were particularly articulate, but was this a consistent?
No, I mean, Giorgio, as I said, is a kind of star in
his
own right. It's fabulous, and he obviously has an incredibly, his way of expressing those, his feelings about cinema and the language to do it, and the, you know, to be sort of self-taught in that sense. So I'd say he's kind of a bit of an outlier, but there are a lot of others who do, and we do have, I mean, there are tendencies when we haven't spoken of really. So for example, we have quite a lot of, in our sample, quite a lot of cinephile men, mostly from the south, it's a kind of strange thing happening in Puglia, with all these kind of men who sort of educated themselves through cinema, left-wing men for whom cinema sort of is this hugely important thing. But what I would say is that although, you know, Giorgio might be a little bit exceptional, and certainly there are lots of them, you know, who can't really express things in the same way, or don't have the same emotional investment quite in cinema. But one of the things we find is that working with video interviews is that just, you know, even kind of tiny things can be really suggestive, you know. So even if someone doesn't have the language, and that often happens, and also, you know, they're having problems with memory sometimes, you know, they can't remember things, and that's very frustrating. But that, you know, if they don't have the language, sometimes their facial expression tells you something, you know, a smile, you know, this kind of wistful, there's a lot of that, you know, this in kind of memory, or a sudden kind of moment of sort of joyous, you know, kind of recollection can tell you an awful lot, I think. About their, you know, this kind of emotional relationship that, you know, what cinema has meant to them. And sometimes it's not about, I mean, as we've said, often it's not really about the relationship with the film itself, and George Wiggins is the exception because he remembers these films in such great detail that he's able to explain. You know, often the emotional memory is about the people that they've seen it with, you know, people who aren't here anymore, people who've died, friends, you know, or kind of just sudden flashbacks to, you know, a day that they went with their father to see films was a very, you know, big thing, you know. So yeah, I mean, as I say, you know, there is a big tension between how the public is thought of and how they actually were, of course. But I mean, you know, and of course we don't want to sort of make some claim that the public were all secretly intellectuals who kind of, you know, have these very sophisticated modes of expression which just weren't recognised, but that actually, you know, I think this is just, I think, one of our, you know, things. There was just so much going on, you know, with them in the memory at the time in that relationship that has just never been, you know, nobody's ever asked them, basically, ever asked them what they thought.
Two related questions. Fascinating presentation. Thank you all very, very much indeed, and thank you for letting me be involved in it. It's been great. And yes, I'm happy to go on doing it. When people reflect back over projects, when complicated projects like you've done and I've been involved in the past, there comes a point where it's really interesting to ask yourself, what's the thing that I'm really glad I did because I think that made a real difference? And what's the one thing you would have done differently? Because now in retrospect you can see. But I want to hear both, because it's too easy to do the self-criticism without doing the equivalent self-praise, saying we got that right, and thank God we did, because it made a real difference. So what would be the real plus from your memory of the project now, and what would be the thing which, if you could have done it differently, you would have?
Well,
I think for us the real plus, and I really meant it, was to get organizations on board in Italy that really supported us. And I think the project could not have happened without them. And that was great. And I think that also, but not just having organizations that were doing that, but also organizations that really understood the spirit of the project. And we really didn't need a lot of sort of intervention in a way. And I think that for me, it's certainly, well, I think that I'm sure there are many, but this is certainly one. No?
Absolutely, yes, yes. I mean, Claire and Memora in particular have been amazing. I think the answer as to what we would do differently.
How much time have we got?
There's a lot of detail. There's a lot of detail in there. But I think there's always a sense that, that there are questions that we would have asked that we didn't ask. And that one only really realizes one should have asked those questions halfway through analyzing the video interviews. Help me out, team.
I know for sure that when I think Sarah was mentioning the fact that for the Stardom, I mean, in some cases, I think the way we formulated the questions in the questionnaire, especially, really, we were a bit disappointed of some of the responses. I mean, I'm not saying overall. But to some of them, and I think that we certainly, well, I think obviously thinking of reflecting it after, we think, well, we should have definitely perhaps asked questions in different ways.
I think for the video interviews, because we gave the Memoro interviewer, and we'd also pointed out that the same interviewer did all the 160 interviews, which is a huge thing, and that is both incredibly positive, but you know, it raises other questions, so we didn't do the interviews ourselves. And we gave him quite strict instructions that he wasn't to prompt, you know, he wasn't to kind of feed names or films or stars, because we wanted within the structure of the interview for it to be as spontaneous as possible. And kind of thinking back on that, I wonder if I would have done that differently. You would just get a different set of responses, you know, that if you showed them prompts, if you showed them magazines from the period, you know, obviously you would get a kind of, you could be directing it in a particular way, but you might get more because, you know, they're struggling to remember names and he's not allowed to tell them, you know, what the name is a bit. And also, I guess, then when you come to use the this is the other thing, you know, because now you think, okay, we're trying to use this material in some way. And so then you would have asked us a very different set of questions, you know, if you want to find out these specific things, you know. So for example, I'm like, you know, thinking about stars, for example, there are some stars who get mentioned all the time and there are some who are never mentioned. And we don't know why that is, you know, and is it that they just don't come to mind so easily, you know, but or they just didn't have a value for these people. And we can't find that out now because, you know, so they're never mentioned, so I think does that mean they were insignificant? Whereas if I had gone in, you know, and asked them about Raffaellone or something, you know, obviously, you know, then I would have got, you know, I would have got a lot of stuff that I could have then used.
Yeah. Or perhaps even just sort of methodologically, perhaps having a first series of video interviews and perhaps follow it up with focus groups and discussions where we would have had the opportunity of sort of really investigate some of those themes a bit further, but
I think questions of intermediality that now sort of relationships with television, music, are things that perhaps now I would pursue further. But again, it was about time restrictions as well. Mm-hmm. We had to get a certain amount into a certain amount of time. So, but yes, we have lots of ideas.
I got a question for all. As this research project changed some way, in a way, your own idea about cinema, or your own idea about being spectator in cinemas?
It's made me realize how terrible my own memory is. The answers we say, oh, people can't remember film titles. I mean, they remember a lot better than I do what I was doing when I was 10 or 12. I mean, that maybe today, and that may say something about the status of cinema in Italy in that period as opposed to the UK. I think it's, on a personal level, it's probably changed me more as a researcher than as a civil spectator. The collaborative research has been a real revelation for me, truly wonderful way of working. So that's the thing that I take from it.
I think it has helped to, I mean, and these are maybe things that we, I mean, and we all come from a slightly particular, you know, perspective anyway, in that we've all worked on popular cinema, and that's kind of what we're interested in anyway. So, you know, we went in with that kind of mentality. But it has kind of reinforced certain things, which I suppose have not really changed us necessarily, but they have maybe given us directions in which to think. You know, so for example, we have a question on the questionnaire, we asked them about neorealism, but then in the interviews we didn't. But we asked a kind of broader question about how did cinema reflect reality in that period, right? To try and sort of see what they were saying. Some of them talk about neorealism, but lots of them talk about actually the films of Matarazzo or the Neapolitan films as being for them realist films. You know, these were films that reflected their kind of life, the way they lived, etc. So that, I guess, has not so much changed, but sort of maybe both reinforced and then kind of helped us to sort of move further in the same direction, in that, you know, hearing those people kind of say that things unhesitatingly, you know, that's what they say, you know, especially the ones who are not maybe aware of neorealism and not thinking, oh God, I have to mention neorealism here, you know, that they're just going to say, yeah, for us, this was realism. And that's been really helpful, I think, because then as researchers, you know, we can kind of go back to that, you know, and sort of use that to kind of help them think, you know, what's happening in that period.
Well, beyond the personal memory, which actually brought back the practice of cinema going, which, I remember as a child, a lot of the practices they talk about, sort of getting into the cinema halfway through the film, waiting for someone to stand up. So it's sort of, that is the personal aspect, obviously. But I think for me particularly is the space, the element of the space in relation to the cinema. So in Giorgio there was a great example of sort of the topography of memory, the importance of the venue, for instance, in relation to the practice of going to the cinema and the journey to the cinema. So not just the film, but everything around and everything outside the cinema, which is certainly something that we want to explore further, the all the aspects that are not just the cinema venue.
I guess the thing that I would take away from it is, well, there's loads of things I would take away from this, but what's really struck me, I suppose, as a non-Italian is doing this project is the very universal nature of the cinema going experience. So it's really allowed me to, it opens up a dialogue with that generation, not just of Italians, but like if I think of my own grandmother or anyone of that generation at home, and you find that there are very similar experiences. Okay, so you move, if I think of my grandmother's experience in Ireland, a lot of what she talks about is also what we found in Italy. So this kind of shared experience across different locales is for me really interesting. And I think that could maybe open up this kind of research to kind of more collaborative work as well, working with other projects in wherever, the UK or any other part of Europe or the world. So I think from a sort of research point of view, it's been amazing because, as Danielle mentioned, it's really this opportunity to work in a team environment, particularly for myself at this point of my very early academic career. It's been really formative, you know. I think it's really shaped the way I would move forward now. So.
There are many things to talk about, but to try and reply to your question specifically. Yes, it has changed my idea of cinema. In two respects. First of all, the role of cinema back in the 1950s, it was huge. It was the only pastime. It was so important. I hadn't realized that it was so important. it really makes you reflect on our, you know, practices of cinema going now, or not going to the cinema, but consuming films in a totally different way. That's one thing. The other thing is, I suppose, as as a scholar, as a film scholar, what film studies really is, and coming from a background of doing textual analysis more than audience and reception studies. So going, actually shifting towards the idea of cinema studies and cinema history, and working with people, the living memories. It was, even at the stage of inputting the data into the questionnaires, and thanks Martina for sharing that moment.
Of course, sorry, I forgot. This is how bad of me, my thinking. Martina spends months in my on my kitchen table inputting data from the questionnaires, often in the worst possible condition, with a barking mad dog and kids running around. So sorry, I don't even know how I sort of forgot that. Thank you. That is my memory.
The mere fact of actually reading and working with, fresh memories of real people who were still alive, it was amazing. I really had the feeling that what we were doing really mattered, especially then when we went back and thanks to UNITRE again to present those results or our results to them. So coming from more traditional background of being on my own and writing up my PhD and watching tons of gangster films and have been very excited about it, it's completely different than actually working with people and hearing their stories and like going back to what Martin was saying this morning, the extent to which some films mattered so much, or the experience of going to the cinema with their father, with their friends. I think it was amazing. So yeah, it has changed my idea of what cinema going has been, what it is now, and makes you think about it very often.
Thank you. For me, the one of the benefits is that you can work with people in the humanities and not die. I really enjoyed my time. The other thing is that economics is extremely limited in what it can do. It has a method and calls itself scientific, but it only gets to a part of a bigger reality. But I think it's important as a bedrock somehow or other for understanding human phenomena in terms of the livelihoods that people had, the way in which they made money, their livelihoods, their relation to other people. So I think that I've enjoyed this so much because it's helped me kind of, if you like, cement the sort of work that I do in a broader project, and that's been very rewarding.
Yeah, I feel like I need to earn my keep since I don't know anything about Italian cinema. But I do know a little bit about humanities administration at a university and about public humanities and digital humanities. And as I was listening to the report, I was thinking about how your experience chimes with an awful lot of new work that's going on in digital humanities and in public humanities. And I was trying to come up with a sort of laundry list of the characteristics of this new kind of work, because I do believe it's the future. And I also believe that if cinema studies has a future, this is it. I also believe that if the humanities has a future, this is it. And I'd like to read this little laundry list of characteristics and see if any of them resonate with you, and if I've left anything out. It seems to me that this kind of work is characterized by being project-based rather than publication-based or book-based or something, that the outputs of this may be multiple and unpredictable at the beginning, but it's going to be around a focus project. Secondly, and clearly, it's collaborative. It's social. But it's collaborative and social in ways that humanists are not accustomed necessarily to working, because that collaboration is not only interdisciplinary, it's trans-domain. It's bringing people together in a team who represent different, literally, fields of knowledge. And that means that they might not give a shit about what the object of the project is initially, but you need to involve them in the spirit of the project if it's going to work. This work is increasingly public-facing. We are no longer doing this work in our offices at universities, but it's out there in communities. And that opens up a whole category of challenges. One of them that you mentioned was finding local partners, organizational partners that you can share, who can share in these projects, and being willing to deal with what museum people are now calling the shared authority of these kinds of projects. These kinds of projects are long tail projects, which means that they may unfold at every period. How many years did you say? 2007? Yeah. I'm involved with the project that's in its third year, and I don't know when it's going to be ending. These projects are also generative. That means that they spin off as many questions, as many other possibilities, as many potentialities as they draw conclusions and bring things to abstraction. So there are a series of issues and challenges that flow from these characteristics. And you mentioned a number of them. One is we now have an ethical dimension to our research that we didn't have when we were sitting by ourselves in a library, Carol, writing a book. We have an ethical responsibility to the people that we work with. And we in the humanities may not know all of the dimensions of those ethical things, as our colleagues in the social sciences and the hard sciences and medicine have been dealing with for a long time. This raises questions of technologies of representation, technologies of documentation, of curation, of sharing, of preservation, that again, we may not be used to in the humanities. And two other things that I'm dealing with. One is, I think we need persistent organizational structures in which this work can be embedded. I think it's very, very difficult to do this kind of project and then reassemble another team from scratch and do a similar kind of project. It would be much easier to do it if there's a persistent organization that learns so that you don't have to go back and reinvent the wheel every time. And finally, I think this raises the issue of the institutional value of this kind of work and the professional value of this kind of work. How is this going? What is the relationship of this work to your own careers in your own institutions? And is this the kind of work that your institutions are going to value and are going to support?
Wow. That's the long list.
What did I leave out?
Has invited me to a meeting in a month's time about our new digital humanities hub. So I'm hoping that's a good sign, and I will take this laundry list with me. Thank you very much.
I think the issue of trying to have a structure that then you can bring forward is really important. And I think that from sort of the attempt on managing the project in sort of in many ways as we did to this one, I think I felt a little bit like sort of juggling different balls, in a sense that you're trying to cut a little bit of a budget somewhere so that you can actually do, in a very secret way, some digitization that is not allowed by your funding body, while trying to get that expertise you're talking about, whether it is sort of economics or geography or anthropology, that we haven't got and that could sort of become a help. And I think that those are real difficulties that, and obviously, especially when you are applying for funding and you have restrictions that don't allow you to do exactly that. So, yeah, I don't really know if there is an answer to, yes, it's great to have that structure, but what if you don't have it, or if you can't afford it, We love to keep Daniel with us, but it's a sort of a, it's because it, and it's great that once you learn certain things, you can progress and do them in a way that is sort of without having to start again from scratch. But it's the difficulty of doing it realistically then.
Or even in a context.
Yeah.
I mean, for example, you know, we're hoping to put in another bid, as Daniel has showed you, to drive this van around and do other things. But, you know, post-Brexit is the British government, you know, going to want to find out about Italian audiences in the 1950s, I kind of wonder, you know. So, you know, there, you know, there are sort of pressures that are kind of, you know, governmental, you know.
I think the model that you presented yesterday has been very helpful, actually, because I will certainly be thinking about ways in which to talk to my institution about how to bring it into teaching as well, because I think that is a way in which there's a kind of double value, if you like, in terms of the structures that sometimes can feel very much that they're pulling us in different directions and shouldn't do teaching and research. So I think that was incredibly helpful thing.
I've got to go now, but I just before I go, I just want to tell you a story about how Daniela got me.
Which is not really something you should say like that on camera.
It's extremely instructive in the sense that I think everyone, a part of the team, all of the people that have been involved in the project will have happened to them too. She came personally to North London. She rang me up beforehand, introduced herself, came personally to North London, you know, one afternoon, early evening I think it was. You'll be surprised to know that we went out and had a pizza. We probably drank more than one bottle of wine, red wine, and then I was completely hooked by the enthusiasm, the charm, and the fact that I was important. And I think that we've all had that experience. It's absolutely wonderful in being able to reach out to people. So.
On this wonderful note that I take it all, I think we should have
Thank you. Hope to see you again soon.
So you're going to come to us.